एग्जाम इज ऑलवेज अ पेन, स्पेशली ड्यूरिंग द कोविड टाइम्स, बिकॉज इट्स वेरी सिंपल एंड स्ट्रेट फॉरवर्ड प्रोसेस इफ यू गो एंड गिव इट ऑन अ टेस्ट सेंटर, ओके, बट गिविंग इट एट अ होम इज लाइक यू नो दे एक्चुअली आर अ पेन इन आर नोज, ओके, सीरियसली. I mean, we cannot murmur our lips and also and all. And knowing that it wasn't my fault, they just escaped by saying a sorry. But for that, the value, the you know, the compensation value of that sorry is I have to give out that exam. Okay. So let's you know start with this particular class today. And today, what are we gonna do? Is actually you all probably know is understanding the chain of custody. Okay. And I'll you know try to showcase, because I don't actually have a ready-made example of a chain of custody yet, right? I asked few of my colleagues who are working in quite a lot of these kind of things to send me a reference. Okay. So still, there are a lot of references given for chain of custody on online Google and also all, right? But I'll you know share the information about chain of custody, right? And at the same time, we are actually going to look at a few of the documents, other documents that are actually required during the seizure, or which are important in dealing with digital evidences. Okay, so I'll start sharing my screen. Is the screen visible? Okay, so let's go into this chain of custody. Small chapter, probably you know it, but I have made notes for this separately to maintain the technicalities, right? So that, yeah, by understanding, you know, to understand, we know the meaning of chain of custody till now. But when in dealings with, you know, making understand to others, or when in terms of someone is asking you about that, we cannot go in layman terms. We have to go a bit into technical terms, right? So here they are. No. Okay, not able to see. I'll just reshare it once again. And after resharing, if someone is not able to see, kindly rejoin the meet. Visible. Shrijit sir, would request you to rejoin if you are still not able to see. So we'll just wait for them to, you know, arrive in the meet again. Yeah, now it's visible. No. Okay, yes, I got a yes. Okay, it's visible for all, I guess now. Yeah. So the recovery of digital evidence is often a complicated process requiring great care to ensure that the evidence is not contaminated and its admissibility is not questioned. This is all something we already know, right? Common pitfalls are often occurred during the recovery and preservation of stages, and it is easy for an inexperienced examiner to ignore evidence. So if there could be a scenario, see, digital evidence is, I already am been, you know, repeating this term, that digital evidence is more volatile even if compared to physical evidence. Yeah, I know it's a biased answer that I'm, you know, actually being a biased over here. Because at any point of time, you will find the versatility and the volatility, you know, you can say the tampering capabilities of physical evidence is much more, right? But considering the scenarios that today digital evidence is an integral part of every crime scene, so digital evidence is more volatile and you can say is more easily tamperable and is to be taken more care, okay, similar to that of physical evidences. And in having a person who is, you know, an experienced, right, examiner who is being just as a beginner, right, it quite, you know, will disturb the admissibility of the evidence and will question its, you know, integrity. Overall integrity of the evidence will be questioned then. Correct. Now, what? So you know, in order to actually make this avoid this, in order to avoid this, simply seizing the evidence and locking it is not just suffice in the court. A formal record cataloging the history of exhibit is required. The court expects exactly the same assurances that applies to other forms of evidence as to safe care of digital evidence. So in order to, you know, make this applicable, the chain of custody is in existence today. So chain of custody is important. Each exhibit acquired and every forensic image made of the data recovered from the devices must be recorded in the detail. This should include a full description of exhibit. A record of acquisition must be recorded. Then the full description of the case references that you are on, the custodian details and the signature of all parties involved while handling the digital evidence. Okay. Now over here, I've still not received the sample COC. Still, if I just, you know, try to Google it up. Can see the template. I think NIST will be a great place. Yeah. Yes, this is absolutely all right. I'll show you this also. Let's not go over this, right? I'll share this also. So this is the chain of custody, basically. This is how it should be formulated. Now, yeah, although some of, you know, maybe dynamic in terms of what is the case that you are actually working on, right, and some of the things such as the victim name is below and the suspect name is above, that some of the things that may depend on the organization or the unit who is in charge of the COC, chain of custody, right? So here is the case number, the offense, the submitting officer, the victim, the suspect, the datum and the time of seizure of the evidence, the location of seizure, right? And now this is the main we can say main portion, the main area where the chain of custody available for. So here is the item. What is the item? Quantity and how, like how many are the numbers in which it has been seized. Description of the evidence, such as the model number, serial number, condition, the size, the capacity, the physical layout, what are the marks, scratches, any damages done on that, any dents on it, right? Like everything is to be noted. Everything. You cannot just, you know, put it out item number one, item, you can just put it out item pen drive, description, it's a SanDisk pen drive. It's not the point that I'm actually trying to refer. You have to mention the things in depth, the model, the serial, the condition, if there are any scratches, the physical condition, the color, right? Everything should be precisely mentioned over here while you're actually adding the description of the evidence. Okay, then this is the another important area where the chain of custody plays an another important role. This is the actual chain of custody, you can say. Documented chain of custody, main, you know, form, this main table is known as the COC itself. Item again here, the date and time of the seizure. Okay, so when did I receive this, the date and the exact time, then released by, so it will be who actually gave to me, that person will actually, you know, fill in this information and give it to me. For example, if it's item, then I'll again, you know, go to that example, it's, you know, it's a pen drive, okay, and suppose it's I received it on you know, it's 12/03/2021, okay, and the time that I released this is 10:42 p.m. okay, let's 10:43 typo. Released by, here it will be my ID and the signature, whatever it is, right? Here received by will be, for example, if I'm sharing it to any one of you who are actually responsible for handling the evidence, So for example, let's consider example of Ayush sir, okay? So received by Ayush, right? And the name and the surname and the signature and the ID, whatever. And the comments, right? Again, you know, over here, Ayush sir can mention something, the condition and all. And he can just mention that what in what state they had received it, right? So this is something which will be filled by me. This is something that will be filled by the person who I'm giving it to, right? And this also for the same. Again, for example, Ayush sir will, you know, repeat this process, but the date and the timestamp will change. Released by Ayush this time right now, and received by, if you are sharing it, for example, if I'm, then Ayush sir is sharing it with, assume Srijit sir. So then Srijit sir will actually mention, you know, his name and ID and all those other things. This is how, regardless of the parties involved, where the evidence goes, this form will be maintained accordingly, compulsorily. In fact, as per the legal norms, I am not liable to give any evidence without filling this detail, and the other person is not liable to actually collect any evidence without, you know, having a signature and the received by. Right? At times, there may be some changes in the tables depending upon what kind of COC documentation you are referring to. But what are the few changes that it may be? The changes will be, the signature will have a separate column. That's the only point, right? These are some of the minor changes that you can observe. But overall, the process and the template yet remains the same, that what are the things has to be included inside the COC, okay? And any examiner is not liable in the court of law, and any evidence, if that examiner is having with him or her, not admissible without maintaining the proper chain of custody. And whosoever will be actually responsible for not maintaining the chain of custody will be the actual person accountable, who will be held for actually, you know, breaking the laws, right? Because just imagine the, you can say, admissibility of the evidence is questioned just on this small document, which is most, like, most important document. The admissibility of the evidence is questioned based on this, right? It doesn't matter to me that, for example, as an examiner, if I'm releasing this pen drive, it's not my concern at all that how Ayush sir is dealing with it. Even he or she, even he is performing any, you know, kind of examination over there or not. I am not concerned about it, right? Regardless of what the other examiner is trying to do or not to do, is there, I have, you know, been present there as in the COC, right? It should be there. Even in fact, you know, I am, you know, sending, you know, I'm giving the pen drive to Ayush sir, and he kept the pen drive with him for a few hours, just lying on the table. Doesn't matter. But COC must be maintained for that, because the evidence was with someone else this time. Okay. And then again, same form, you know, goes still down. And this is another important area, which is the final disposal authority. Okay. I'll zoom in over here. Yeah, zoom. Yeah, final disposal authority and authorization for disposal. Items, the items that have been mentioned over here on this document pertaining to the suspect is or are no longer needed as evidence. Okay. Okay, the disposal evidence and is or are authorized for disposal by check of the appropriate disposal method, return to owner or auction, destroy or divert, name and ID of the authorizing officer, signature and the timestamp. Witness to destruction of evidence items on these documents were destroyed by the evidence custodian, whatever the name is, ID, in my presence, whoever is the witness, right, may even could be the, you can say the examiner, name and ID of the witness to destruction, signature and again the timestamp. Released to lawful owner, items on this document was released to evidence custodian, were released by, again the same things. Two, name, in case of, you know, the who is, you know, the owner of the particular evidence that has been, you know, collected, if they are returning, if there is a need, if they, if it's not to, you know, destruct, if the evidence is not to be destructed, then if it's you know made to return it, then this is the statements that will be you know provided over here. Under penalty of law, I certify that I am the lawful owner of the above items. Signature, copy of government issue for photo identification attached. Yes, it should be attached, right? As a permanent record, so it should be considered as a permanent record by anywhere police department. Like what it's trying to say, this is an important document. That's all. Just try to understand this. So, it's you know quite important to know about these aspects, and it's easy. And I mean, it's important to know about this chain of custody also. What I am doing is I am just sharing this sample chain of custody with you all on the Skype as of now itself. And well, I guess there could be no doubts regarding this, right? It's a very simple process to understand. Anyone still any doubts? And this the template I've you know as of in front of you, I've officially downloaded it from the NIST site, NIST.gov.in, right? So it is something which is acceptable. Any doubts for now? Anyone? No one? Okay. Let's proceed. Then here now, what are we going to do further is to look at some of the other documents, which are quite important. Just ignore some of the, you know, pages that I'll be showing you in the document. Actually, I've scanned it via my mobile phone, right? So, you know, maybe due to the fact, yeah, you're due to the fact that I've scanned it via mobile phone, so on a proper orient format. But yeah, by you know, once I'll be you know uploading them on Edmodo and adding you till today or max till tomorrow in the Edmodo platform, I'll be sharing you the invite link. It will be there in a structured manner over there, right? So what this form is about, okay, so I'll be, you know, we'll be actually seeing the documents. So this document is in regards to the seizure record, okay? So this seizure record is again an important document to maintain. And these are the templates, basically. What these are the documents or these are the records that you need to maintain along with the COC, right? Otherwise, again, it will be not admissible. So this is a seizure record, right? So acquisition details, here you have to add location of seizure, full address, everything you have to mention. Was the equipment mounted? This is kind of, you understand whatever I'm showing you over now will be a kind of checklist. Checklist for different types of digital evidences and the documents that they pertain to along with the COC. Okay. Was the equipment mounted? Yes, no. Was the equipment attached to a communication line at the? Yes, no. Movement switched on at the time of seizure? Again, the question. If yes, please state how the equipment was switched off and secured. So here the reasons will be there. That what are the measures that have been taken to actually switch off and secure the evidence that you have seized. Was the equipment password protected? Were able to get password from owner? If yes, then what is the password? Has the equipment since being, if yes, please state the reason and the details of the person who turned it on and why. Is the list of application running on equipment available? If it was in on state, there might be some applications or, you know, processes running, right? Then if yes and no, according to that, are the photos of the scene taken? Is there any sketch produced? Attach them if there are. Then image creation. Application for imaging. The image has to be made, correct? This specifically under of example, considering of, you can say a disk, right? Application that is used to create an image, version of the application, the write blocker, if there are any, what are the write blocker application type and version that you have used. Did the hashes of the original and the image match? This is most important. Yes. If the hash file is attached, yes, the highest files are attached. It needs to be attached, basically. Okay. Next, in what we have for the document, and out of this, somewhere I have not included it because this page is everywhere. Okay. After every document that you adhere to, this page or this area is a must. This tab is a must. This form. So every, like as of now, we saw the seizure form. Then we'll be seeing, system configuration. Not system configuration exactly. Yeah, first a system configuration. Then we'll be seeing mobile phones. So after every, form that you adhere to, this list will be there. So I've not, just repeated it again and again, again and again, right? So understand, this is important over here. Forensic analyst making seizure. So this is nothing but details about the, you can say, examiner who is doing the seizure, the forensic investigator. Full name, the title, the phone, the department, the comment, signature, date and time, witness signature, who was actually witnessing this. Again, the same details for that. Nothing new, it's not rocket science. But this is same repeated everywhere, right? Now, this is something which is important. System configuration list. This all contained and it. In fact, I'll be telling you a very, very, very simple, straightforward, and the most easiest method for automatically generating this document in your Windows operating system. Right? For others operating system too, but for Windows, it's the most simple and the easy one. Anyone who knows can put it down in the chat, right? So make the type, the OS installed, the processors, the motherboard information, the RAM, everything. I'm not even going into the subsets such as make, type, capacity, and speed, right? Hard disk make, CD drive, CD writer, DVD writer, DVD reader, SSCI card make, network card, sound card, video card, floppy drive, keyboard, mouse, and other peripherals is to be noted. Depending upon the machine that you have been, and you can say working upon. Then again, I said the same form will be repeated again. See over here, right? This is in terms to either with mobile phones. Okay, so you can say this is about checklist provided for the mobile phones. The document. So what will be the mobile phone type? Mobile phone serial number, IMEI number. Then again, size, it will include height, width, and depth. This information will be also included. Yes. Weight, capacity, the display, what are the dimensions of the display, the screen resolution, other specifications, says is the, you can say, display OLED, AMOLED, whatever. Specifications, frequency, audio format supported, video format supported, headphones, what is the frequency response, impedance value, languages, power and battery, battery type, playback time, music playback time, photo slideshow with music view time, video playback time, charging time. These are some of the documents when it comes to seizure of mobile phones. And after this, again, you can see the same form. Yeah, is repeated. See, not the same form exactly, but here are a few of the more subset of questions, such as location of the seizure. Was the mobile phone switched on during the seizure? If yes, then how the equipment was switched off and secure? Was the equipment password protected? If yes, who was able to give the password? How and what is the password? Has the equipment been switched off once being seized? If yes, please state the reason that why it is being switched on. If it was off, are the photos and the scenes again the same thing? Again, for the image creation that you already know. And again after this, okay? The details for the forensic examiner who actually have seized, and the details of the witness will be there. So this, you have to maintain alongside. Going for the next one. So again, I said just ignore while scanning. There were some problems, in some of the pages while scanning it properly. Okay. So this is about the CD. So CD type of CD, full address, was the CD inserted into a drive? Are the scenes of the photo taken? Yes, no, same. Again, the things used for image creation, right? And again, after this, the details of the forensic examiner seizing it and the details of the witness. Now, the next document is for flash drives, pen drives, you can say, right? Again, the make, type, model, input, output, speed will matter in case of pen drives. Flash drive acquisition details, location of seizure. Was the flash drive mounted? Running seizure. If yes, then how was the equipment switched off and secure? Has the flash drives, you know, put it somewhere after seizure? If yes, why and who? Are the photos of the taken? If yes, is there any sketches produced? If yes, attach those things. Image creation, again the same things, and again the details of the forensic examiner and the witness over here. Now this is something in terms of hard disks. So what make the hard disk, serial number, product number, capacity of the hard disk, again the same sum of the things, same, like those things are repeated depending upon the digital evidence. The questions are a bit changed, the values are changed depending upon the evidence type. Was it mounted, was the system switched off, why, and all the reasons. Again the same procedures over here, and image creation and the person who seized it and the witness. This is for switches, right? When it comes to switches have been used, right? So switch type, switch serial number, specification of a switch, number of ports, buffer memory of the switch, max bandwidth that the switch supports, network latency, address database size, forwarding mode if any, sensing mode what of the switch, standard compliances involved, safety agency approval if there are any who have approved the switch, and the power requirement of the switch. Again the acquisition details, why it was on and off, right, the address and all, forensic analyst again, and the witness analyst. Witnessed over here, right? Then going next, it's in the terms of router, right? So the type of router, router serial number, size specification, height, width, etc. The same thing such as switch, some of the things have been added, address database size, forwarding, okay, so number of VPN tunnels, power requirements and all those other things, I mean number of VPN tunnels, router acquisition details. Were the router logs being recovered? Yes, then attach them. Was the device password protected? So this is an additional point over here in terms of routers. Then the same. Then investigation for a checklist. Like investigation, the checklist for the hub. Hub, right? Hubs is another set of equipment. So make, the type, the serial number, specification, number of ports, max bandwidth, you know, network latency, number of VPN tunnels. Same things, such as for the other network devices. Other questions? So I think the order has been appended now. It's correct. The person who handled the switch or hub after it was seized, that was it turned on, turned off. Again, the same things. Again, the forensic and the witness details, right? Now, this last checklist that I've been, that I'll be showing you is in terms of physical security checklist. Okay, so lights, are the lights automatic? Are the lights, you know, the environment, the physical security environment? Are the lights public? Are the public places light? Can authorized person access the switches and the lights? Are the lights on both night and day? On in both night and day? Receptionist trained to identify unauthorized visitors? The guard to check who is in space, parking is reserved for certain authorities. Alarm, is there any ID, intrusion detection system, IDS? Is it terminated at the concerned department? The alarms for supplies and regulated, yes or no? Emergency exit, so what are the things, yes or no, that you have to, you know, place a tick marks. It's like kind of a checklist. Are the emergency exits, you know, situated in a proper location? Server room, is the server room locked when not monitored? Does it raise alarm if unauthorized person enters? Access control, something again important in terms of corporate investigations. Is the entry based on the authenticity of each individual passing through the gate? Is the authentication mechanism trustworthy? Do you use biometric scanners? Do you use fingerprint scanners to identify the personnel who are actually responsible for or accountable for these access controls? Memory locked, are the devices and their associated elements secured using locks? Power system rooms, is the power system unregulated? is the room and its equipment insulated? Storage areas and backup areas, right? So are they secured against physical threats such as blood? Destroying to be destroyed by the due to the magnetic field, doors, windows, openings, private locations or elevators, security guards and remote access, right? These are some of the you can say checklist. I mean, not some, maximum of the things I've already, you know, covered as a checklist over here. Correct. So any doubts till now? Anyone? What if someone is still getting you? Are you actually talking about a crime over here? Then if it's a yes, then we'll discuss about it later. Yeah, right. We have still a few time left, and what I'm going to demonstrate is just a moment. Let me turn on my Windows system. Okay, let's start this one. Let me just try to see where my pen drive is located, because I have the tools inside. So just give me a moment, please, while it's booting. Okay, just a moment, just a minute. Okay, so the system is started. I still haven't found my pen drive. Just give me a minute. I mean, there are some other tools also inside it, which I wanted to demonstrate, but I have another thing for that as well. Just a minute. Yeah, here it is. Let me just try to check if there is a tool. Okay, just a minute. So here am I in my Windows. Let me just check if the defender and all is done, because there are some tools in my pen drive which I don't want to lose. So security. Yeah, okay, cool. No security setting will actually, you know, bother me. you'll easily get a moment or two what I'm actually trying to demonstrate. Just a minute, I'm just inserting my pen drive. Devices, USBs, sticks. Not able to. Okay, here is the 16-inch. Just a minute. Yeah, here is. Just try to copy and drag and drop in my Windows. Yeah, so I mean, I'll obviously tell you for other OS too, but just to in a sake of give an example, because we have referred to a document, right? And one of the document was system information, correct? So just, you know, as a, you know, as a course of showing a small demo to you, this is a tool basically that I've been using on, I mean, you know, we use basically quite a lot of, not quite a lot, but almost every time basically, you actually get the insight of the system information. It is known as Win Audit. Okay. I just have to run it as an admin. And you can see this blue bar over here. See, it's going on. It will be, you know, finishing in a while. We just have to wait for a while. I can see a Skype pop up. So someone has some doubt. So it takes some time to complete the entire audit. Let's just wait and do not disturb this. Yeah, done. You can see this. Entire, if you, you know, try to reopen the document and see all this kind of things. All has been actually, everything has been provided by this Win Audit tool. Correct? See, everything is mentioned. The system overview, the installed software, answer inside that also installed or no, active setup, installed programs, right? I'll just expand this list, see. Operating system, peripherals, security. What are the security policies basically, right? In fact, I've changed some of the security policies in this system. So not for Kerberos, but network time protocol. Let's me check. Permissions, you can see. What are the things we are actually then if it's just registry set values, security logs. Right, you can see all of these things. Security settings. User privileges. User right assessments. And it's not just a one tab. Within security settings, you can see these are all the options within the security settings tab. Then system restore, user privileges, user right assessment, groups and users, so what are the groups, group policy, right, again, users, administrator, default, guest, you can say Spider-Man, right, Urvesh Thakkar, my own user, something that is in utility which is running and its own user, right, Windows Defender, scheduled tasks, uptime statistics, environmental variables, you can say adapters, open ports, routing tables, hardware devices. See this, like the list is endless now. Display capabilities, display adapters. See, I'm in VirtualBox, it's showing me VirtualBox. BIOS version, if you go into system management, then more BIOS details, system information, baseboard, right, chassis, processor, it's not showing any because I'm into a virtual in our actual environment, it will show a lot more things. Cache information, these are some of the information, it's not available in virtual, because I'm running in a virtualized environment. Processors, memory, drives, again C and D are the two drives that are created. Startup programs. Services, all the services are mentioned then over here. And just, go away and check up, right? Running programs and all. And at the same time, what you can do is, you can just, configure that what you want to show. Metering is, I've just disabled by default. You can enable those as well. You can email this. You can just, save it in a web page or an HTML format, in a CSV format, CSV2 or RTF format, right? So if I just choose into HTML and then go into, I'll just save it on a desktop. Right. You can also export this audit database if you want to, in terms of database exporting. And are some of the other things which you can actually, this is the firmware information view. Separately, if you want to just, display it out, disk information, right? So, and now what I'll do is I'll just open that TXT file, HTML file, and choose Google Chrome. And here we are with all the tabs. Great tool for gaining complete insight on everything about the system. Yeah, it's just the overview of the hardware. And in my case, some of the things may be not be seen because I'm running in a virtual, which doesn't imply over there. So you could try to run this in your own machine, physical machine, right? Do you log all this info? Is it the part of the investigation? Yes, obviously. I'm not saying the fact that everything is should be considered as in part, but the maximum you consider, and the better visibility you provide of the machine, the better it will be for you to understand the environment, the better it will be for you to we could say retrieve the digital evidence, the better it will be. Just ignore the part of you, but let's consider the part from the overall investigation. Better it will be of other people who are involving into the case. It will be better for the people to understand who are actually, dealing with this. At the same time, it will help us to maintain the records. Also, this document also is admissible in the court. I mean, it has to be there. Because you cannot just, you know, simply go up and seize any thing, right? There should be the state and the information provided of the machine. Is this recorded by serial numbers? In what sense? I'm like, could you just elaborate the question?
Yeah, hi, Alvesh. Basically, I'm just curious if all the information what you've collected from the computer, mm-hmm. it's obviously okay, but it doesn't have any proof that it was collected from that computer.
So, yeah, but whatever are the hardware, the things that are present for the hardware, they do actually are based on the serial numbers, basically.
Yes, and this was my point, basically. Do we need just to check what is the hardware serial number so we can put it also into...
Yeah, required. If it's, you know, if in certain cases, if it's not, you can say admissible, that someone is trying to question its integrity, then you have to just, you know, go into that, in depth to that. Mostly it's not required to actually, you know, go and cross verify that this is the actual system on which we have it run, right? Because Win Audit, Freeware, I mean, these kind of tools are actually approved. The results that are actually we present, they are actually approved by the court. I mean, these are the things which are not, you can say, which are, it's not something which is question visibility. Still, as a part C, it's not a thing that you have to only rely on this. Whenever an examiner or whenever as an investigator, you will seize the machine, most of the time it is important for you to understand, you know, keep the serial number also included with you, regardless if it's needed or not needed. It is quite important because apart from all these details, the actual things that are there inside the machine are to be, you know, you can say noted.
But what about the people who are doing this, basically? Because it could be different departments, so they probably have different trust boundaries. So if different? This is coming from that IT department, it's by all means, it's, you know, valid 100% or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm here just questioning, basically, those permissions, basically, who can basically substitute those papers. For instance, if you collect one thing, the crime was done with other thing. And basically, you can just substitute the hardware, saying it was not like 8 cores, but it was 2 cores machine.
No, sir, that's not the case. And the person in charge, I mean, it's not as different subsets that have been, you know, made for dealing with different kind of information. If there will be only one particular examiner assigned to actually collect and audit the particular system, so he will be the one actually analyzing everything. Not it's not, you know, divided opportunity for everyone.
Okay, I see. Thanks.
Yes. So, let me. Oops, I'm not able to access. Am I audible?
Yes.
Well, my system is completely stuck. I guess it's okay if I'm audible, that's cool. But my system is completely stuck right now. Don't know why.
Yeah, this is what happens when you use the virtual box.
No, it's not the first time, but I don't know what's the actual consequence. Because this is nothing, like I've been running 3 or 4 instances at the same time in the virtual box. So till now it's, yeah, got the point. The point is Skype is using a lot of memory in the backend, and same goes with the virtual box. So
absolutely, probably it's really
probably
hungry.
While, yeah, and this is a thing that I do in other classes. I don't, you know, conduct when there are the demos which are very harsh and the system is turning into barbecue. I just avoid Skype and I just, you know, post out a Google Meet link. Anyways, guys, what I was just trying to say is it's already 11:22, and what I'll do is I'll just, you know, wind up this session over here, right, as of now. Okay. And I'll be sharing you that Win Audit EXE file on WhatsApp group and also on Skype chat. Okay. So try to do that thing in your own system. And also the documentation I'll be sharing that I've been showing you today. Okay. That's all from my end for today. My system is stuck basically. I'll do anything, but if I get my voice clearly, so I'll just, you know, wind up over here. Cool for everyone?
Just a quick question before you go.
Yeah.
What kind of, how do you know what kind of information needs to be presented? Because I saw in that Vim audit program, it has lots of information, like about the hardware,
right,
about the policy, about the security, about everything, basically. But
right,
I would add that it's even missing something, you know? So how do you know this thing?
Yeah. So for the crucial ones, sir, the document which I just showed you, right? The PDF, okay? I'll be sharing that. In that, whatever the information is mentioned is the most crucial. You can say is mandate, in fact. Okay, such as OS, processor, motherboard, RAM, hard disk, CD, DVD writers, video cards, sound cards, keyboard, mouse, or any other information.
Yeah, I get it. I mean more about information was stored or was retrieved or was used on the hardware itself. For instance, it's nothing says, it does says a lot about the operating system configuration, but it doesn't says anything about the user profile, what mostly used programs were. It doesn't says about anything to point what the activity was done on that computer.
Right. Now, sir, the answer to this question is, I was just, in the PDF, I was just mentioning about the, you know, to be included things, right? At the same time, when you saw the audit, Win audit software, you saw a lot of things. I mean, everything that has been present in detail, right? So now the two scenarios are here. Like, what are we supposed to, you know, how I was being supposed to told is to actually, you know, create this.